Hi everyone, and welcome to today's Google Developers Live for Google Drive. Today I'm going to relive a little bit of my former life before I was working on Drive, and talk a little bit about the Google Apps Marketplace. There's a lot of developers who have been in the Google Apps Marketplace for the past couple of years, and who have been integrating with Google Docs using the Documents List API. And lately, just been getting a lot of questions from those developers on how they can take those applications and start leveraging some of the new features in the Google Drive API. And it actually turns out pretty easy to get started. There are some limitations, a couple different options in how you can do it. So I'm going to go over just two or three different approaches. And show how they work, what the pros and cons of the different approaches are, and where you kind of start running into limitations. For those who are not familiar with the Google Apps Marketplace, it is it's an enterprise storefront, really designed for small businesses, but it's where developers can register their applications, and then domain administrators for Google Apps can go and install those applications for all of the users on their domain. It's been around for a few years. Some really great applications in there, and more, still keep coming on every day. But when it was written, it was actually done pre-Drive. It was actually when Drive was still referred to as Google Docs. Documentation and everything is still really geared towards the older API, some of the older authentication mechanisms like OAuth1 instead of OAuth2, and so on. And so, it creates a little bit of confusion about how you can use some of the newer APIs that Google is doing with the enterprise storefront. So I want to go into our developer console for the marketplace here. I just had this, I'm logged in. I already created this app a while back, just called GDL test. And I'm gonna just go in and edit this listing. This is actually, you're already created here for using the Google Doc List API. So I actually have the scope reference here. It's maybe a little hard to see, and make it a little bit bigger if I can. So you see the scope ref doc list, and this is just the old Google Docs feed. And here in my test domain, I have this apps rocks domain, and I have this app already installed. I have a really simple test application here. This is just a little bit of a command line application using the Ruby client. What this has in here is just our client ID and secret. We're using two-legged OAuth1, and I'm just going to do a request for the Documents List API impersonating a user using XOAuth requester ID, and then print out the results. And life is good. So we see the results. Not really worried about formatting any of this. It's really just to see, are we getting back a valid response or not? So basically, all we just showed is that Marketplace apps work with the Documents List API. That's something that we already knew. All right. So what happens when we switch over, instead of using the Documents List API, we actually just go and use the Drive API? And in this case, what we actually get back is a result. Wasn't actually the result I expected, but let me go and do one other thing. Actually, no, that is correct. The point is it actually just works. And the reason this works is really for one simple reason, which is the Documents List scope is actually respected by the Drive API. And is treated as equivalent to the full Drive scope. There are a couple catches. One couple things I want to point out in how I actually set this up here. So one is I want to go over to back to our Google Apps Marketplace, go to our vendor profile, and there's a couple things you can see here. There's in our console for the marketplace, there is this link underneath each application, which says register for additional APIs. What that will do, let's close that other one, is take us to a version of the Google API console that is tied to our marketplace app. And what we can do is that, you know, for the marketplace, we can then go and turn on different services such as the Drive API. So one other thing, though, that has to happen for this to work reliably, which is the API key. Normally, the API key is something you would only use in the context of unauthenticated API requests. So if you're using some of the APIs which aren't necessarily tied to user data, but still need to be tied to an API project, you would use the API key as a way to link any of those API calls to your specific instance of the console. And this is used for quota enforcement, for reporting, various other features. For various reasons, normally if you're using authenticated requests rather, and you have, this is automatically done for you by virtue of your OAuth credentials. So when you authenticate a user, you have a token. That token is bound to your application, and also, of course, bound to your API console project, so we can track quota. For the marketplace, due to the way that the keys are generated for your application, that binding isn't really there. And what you need to do in the case of a marketplace app, in addition to, signing your request with your application key, your application client key and secret, so you also need to set the API key. Most of the client libraries, this is pretty easy. In the case of Ruby, for example, we just do this once when we create the client. So even though we're still doing an authenticator request, we're still signing with our app's credentials, we still need this one additional bit of information to make sure that we have that correct binding to our application. The upshot of that is we do actually get reporting. You can see here's a request we just made today. We get quota enforcement. It makes it a little bit easier for us if your application is a high uses a lot of API quota and you need additional traffic, additional QPS. We can actually set those for your project. If you don't do that, what ends up happening is you end up kind of falling into a generic bucket of quota, which then makes it a little bit more unpredictable for your application. So that's really the easiest way that you can actually start using the Drive API features. One of the other things that people have tried, and I'm actually going to go show you what happens, is I'm going to go and edit this listing. And I have another scope in here. I have already put this in a little earlier, but I put in a scope for the Drive, the new Drive scope here. So you can see it's a little bit different. This is the new format, googleapis.com/auth/drive, which is a little bit different than the old docs one. And I'm going to go and change this reference here to Drive. And we'll save that. I want to show you what happens. What ends up happening is a little bit of a UI issue. This will actually work. So if I go back and try this, we'll actually get back a 200 response. Everything is fine. So 200, that's good. But here, what we lose, instead of having that really nice, human-friendly text that says, integrates with Google Docs, we just get the raw scope. And this is just mostly a bug on our side. There is a feature request to update the marketplace to have all the latest scopes. So while this will technically work, it loses some of the features in terms of the presentation. And it also means that, let's make this a little smaller, when you do things like searching the marketplace, there are some features here for where you can filter application based on the type of integration. Applications that are using the Drive scopes are not going to show up correctly in this filter. So while it might be your first instinct is to, I'm using the Drive API, let's use the Drive scope, you do miss out on a lot of the marketplace features in terms of the benefits for discoverability of your application. So really the trick to doing this is use the old documents list scope, but use the new API so that you get the simplicity of the API, the more efficient wire protocols, and of course some of the new features that are coming out and that we have in our early access program that we announced earlier in the week, or actually about a week or two ago. There's one other thing that comes up in part of this. So, you know, those who have been building, newer drive applications are probably familiar with what we have in the Chrome Web Store, which is these applications. And one feature we've been promoting is the ability for applications to hook into the new UI for a drive, to be in the create menu, to be able to open files from the Explorer. In fact, there was an announcement earlier today about how that experience has changed to really help promote third-party applications, make that experience of connecting apps much better. And as part of this, we have two different ways that applications can get installed into Drive. One is via the Chrome Web Store, and the other is via an OAuth scope. So there's a scope, drive.install, which does the same thing that you would have for if you installed via the Chrome Web Store, of having that app appear in Google Drive. So of course, then the question is, well, can you do this from the apps marketplace? So if, for example, we were to go into our app settings, and here, so we have these different scopes. You have a drive scope. If I were to add a drive.install scope and then include that into our app, the question is, would that actually work? And unfortunately, the answer to that is no, it doesn't. Due to the way that that scope is enforced and checked, it only works when it's actually a grant to an individual user, not when it's a domain-wide grant. There are some things you can do as a hybrid model if you are an application which is in the Google Apps Marketplace and you really love those features of being able to do these domain-wide authorizations, but you still want to get that UI integration. Just do a hybrid model, right? So you can have the domain administrator install your app that gives you data access for all the users on the domain, but then as they become users of your application, just have an upsell or some other promotion within the application to say, hey, not only can you use our app here, but you can get all these really cool other features like appearing in the Drive UI, so you can create docs directly. Open our application from within Drive, click here to install that extension. Then you could either use the OAuth, the drive.install scope to connect that application or point them to the Chrome Web Store instead. So a couple different options for how you can do that. Honestly, it's not nearly as polished as it would be, as I would like it to be. There are, are things that we're looking at to make this experience a lot better, but a lot of interest in having those domain-wide deployment features combined with some of the new things that have been happening in the Chrome Web Store, something that we're looking at, but it's just not available today. But the good news is that if you are in the Google Apps Marketplace and you have an existing Docs integration, there's really no reason why you shouldn't start looking at migrating to the new Drive API. You can still leverage the two-legged OAuth and the domain-wide grants that you have today. You just need to do a little bit of work just to enable that project, use the API key, and then you can start using the Drive API and any of the new features that are in there. So that's really it. Again, it's something that a lot of questions from developers, but turns out to be really simple to do. And other than that, I think that's all for today. If there's any questions, certainly feel free to ask on the Google Drive developers community, Stack Overflow, or those who find me on Google Plus, just send me a note and I'll be happy to help. Other than that, stay tuned for next week's Google Developers Live. Great, thanks.